members, including two U.S. military personnel. That plane then returns to Tripoli, and the first rescue team that is there is now really engaged in the attack. You have no idea, as my understanding, as to when the attack is going to end. So the second rescue team is preparing to go. And I want you, you mentioned it in your opening statement, but if you could please go back to what the second team, now the second team included four U.S. military. These are highly trained special forces personnel, one of which is a medic. And yet these military personnel do not operate under your authority, and your permission is not enough for them to go. Explain to me again exactly what happened.
Again, we determined that we needed to send a second team from Tripoli to secure the airport for the withdrawal of our personnel from Benghazi after the mortar attack.
But were any of these U.S. military personnel not permitted to travel on a rescue mission or relief mission to Benghazi?
They were not authorized to travel.
What happened with those personnel?
They remained in Tripoli with us. The medic went with the nurse to the hospital to lend his skills to the treatment of our and care of our wounded.
How did the personnel react to being told to stand down?
They were furious. I can only say, well, I will quote Lieutenant Colonel Gibson. He said, "This is the first time in my career that a diplomat has more balls than somebody in the military."
So the military is told to stand down, not engage in the fight. These are the kind of people willing to engage. What did, where'd that message come down? Where'd the stand down order come from?
I believe it came from either AFRICOM or SOC Africa.
And my understanding is that General Hamm was actually not in Stuttgart, where AFRICOM's headquartered, but he was in Washington, D.C. Is that correct?
I don't know the whereabouts of General Hamm on that night.
Mr. Chairman, this is something that we're going to have to continue to explore. I need to move quickly now to Mr. Thompson, if I could. You were the leader there at the what's called the FEST within the State Department. According to the State Department website, the FEST is the Foreign Emergency Support Team, the U.S. government's only interagency on-call short-notice team poised to respond to terrorist attacks worldwide. I want to read to you an excerpt of an email sent by you to Kathleen Austin Ferguson on Tuesday, September 11, 2012 at 9:58 p.m. Could you help me understand who is Kathleen Austin Ferguson?
She's Undersecretary Kennedy's deputy.
You wrote, quote, "I am told that Pat Kennedy participated in a very senior conference call with the White House and discouraged a FEST option. To remind, FEST has dedicated aircraft able to respond in 4 hours, is Department of State-led and provides the below skills. When FBI was contacted, they responded that this situation would be better addressed via a FEST response. Thus, there are others who are thinking the same way, ready to discuss further as needed." Mark, two questions.
Can the gentleman suspend for a moment? Earlier, there was one document that had not been placed in the record because it hadn't been provided through official channels. And I'd ask that we get that. I think it came from Mr. Gowdy. And then, Mr. Chaffetz, if you could make your document available so we could make copies. And then for any other members on either side of the dais, if you plan to use a document that is not currently committee record, and I realize since we've gotten very little, there's very little committee records, please do us the favor of having copies so they can be distributed at or prior to the beginning of the questioning. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Mr. Chairman, one thing. Mr. Chairman, as you recall, yesterday I reminded you that we had never, with regard to Mr. Thompson, this is the first time we've gotten a syllable from him.
Right, and, we have no transcript of it either.
But let me go on. One of the things I said in our conversation is that if there were any documents that were going to be used, we'd like to have had them yesterday. But with the regard to this document, and it sounds like it's a very crucial document, and in fairness to everybody, to all of us, and to Mr. Nordstrom, who said he wanted a complete hearing, we'd just like to have that document, even if we had to suspend. We'd like to see the document that he's talking about. You know.
Okay. In the case of this particular document, Mr. Chaffetz is. My understanding is you do have the document. So I'll let staff work on that and provide additional time if needed. If that turns out not to be true, For our witnesses, if you have any documents you are going to refer to that we don't have, if you would have your counsels allow copies to be made. Again, I want to make sure everyone has it as soon as possible. Obviously, if the State Department had made the documents they show us so-called in camera, if they had allowed us to have copies, we would all have a lot more documents. But
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That is for a different argument. Mr. Chaffetz, I am sorry, we will give you back a couple of seconds and you, the gentleman may continue.
Mr. Thompson, do you recall that email?
I do.
Two questions. Were you ever given a detailed explanation as to why the FEST was not considered for deployment? And number two, did you attend or attempt to attend any senior meetings to plead your case for a FEST deployment? And if so, what happened?
The reason I was given was that this was not the time for the FEST. It might be too unsafe for the FEST. And I got that through Ms. Austin Ferguson. I readdressed that with her. I readdressed it with her staff 2 days later.
Did you attempt to attend any meetings?
The next morning there were VTCs. I presumed I would be part of that. I was told not to attend those. Although CT was represented there, the FEST portion and the response portion of the Counterterrorism Bureau was not represented there.
So why were you not called into action? This is what you trained for. It's what tabletops are for. It's what you're prepared to do. Why was FEST not called into action?
I do not know.
Mr. Chairman, this is one of the great mysteries. Here we have this expertise. We've invested heavily in it. They tabletop it. They understand it. This is exactly what they trained for, and they were never asked to go into action. We had no idea how long or when this was going to end. Yield back.
I thank the gentleman, and the gentleman is correct. We now recognize the lady from, the gentlelady from the District of Columbia, Ms. Norton, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Thompson, first I want to say to the families that we continue to feel deeply about your loss. I have some questions for Mr. Thompson concerning the role of the Counterterrorism Bureau. Now, Mr. Thompson, your lawyer said you were unwilling to talk with any Democratic member of this committee, so I've had to rely on statements that were made to the press. Your own statement is mostly biographical about the work you've done in Yemen and Latin America and the rest. Now, one report I found indicated that you believe that Secretary Clinton and Ambassador Patrick Kennedy, and here I'm quoting from this report, tried to cut the Counterterrorism Bureau out of the loop as they and other Obama administration officials weighed how to respond to and characterize the Benghazi attacks. Now, that's the end of that quote. Mr. Thompson, I'm asking you, is that a quote, is that quote accurate, that you believe that the Counterterrorism Bureau was intentionally kept out of the loop for political reasons?
It is not. I indicated that the portion of the Counterterrorism Bureau that responds to crises, i.e., part of the office, was pushed out of that discussion. The Counterterrorism Bureau was represented in subsequent meetings after the night of 9/11.
So, do you believe you were kept out for political reasons? This quote
I do not politicize my job, madam. I have served under three presidents, starting with President Clinton, up to the present. I have served six secretaries.
I've got to continue. Mr. Thompson, I was just quoting the quote. So the quote isn't entirely accurate then?
Correct.
All right. That's very important for the record, that Mr. Thompson is not saying that they were kept out of the loop for political reasons. This week, this quote apparently caused your former boss in the Counterterrorism Bureau at the State Department, I'm speaking now of Ambassador Daniel Benjamin, to issue a public statement disagreeing with this allegation in particular, which was in quotes. And he said, and I am now quoting him, it has been alleged that the State Department's Counterterrorism Bureau was cut out of the discussion and decision-making in the aftermath of the Benghazi attacks. I ran the Bureau then, and I can say with certainty that former, as the former coordinator for counterterrorism, that this charge is simply untrue. Do you agree with Ambassador Benjamin?
I agree that the Counterterrorism Bureau was included, but there's a distinction with a difference with respect to the portion of the Counterterrorism Bureau that would be most effective in the aftermath of an attack.
Now, all of this was under Ambassador Benjamin. He didn't say one portion or the other. You are yourself saying, although the Bureau was represented, somehow some portions of the Bureau were not represented. And why, how is that?
That's what happened, ma'am.
It says the Bureau, he says, going on, was a central participant in the interagency discussion about the longer-term response to Benghazi. At no time was the Bureau sidelined or otherwise kept from carrying out its task. Now, this seems to me to directly contradict your testimony here today.
Well,
he says,
I respectfully disagree.
We were all in. You say, well, yeah, you were in, but somehow the other, some part of it was not in.
No other part of the Counterterrorism Bureau is responsible for responding to a crisis. This was a crisis. My office was not involved in those subsequent meetings. Other members of the office were very professional people, and I'm sure they did their best at those meetings.
Well, we certainly don't want to get involved in you know, who down the chain of line gets consulted. But the ambassador says after the attack, the first question to arise that involved the Counterterrorism Bureau was whether or not the Foreign Emergency Support Team should be deployed. The question of deployment was posed early, and the Department decided against such a deployment. In my view, it was appropriate to pose the question, and the decision was a correct one. Now, were you aware that your superiors were consulted about the decision not to employ the Foreign Emergency Support Team?
Go ahead and answer that, although the gentlelady's time has expired.
As earlier indicated, ma'am, I was told that by the Undersecretary of Management's office. The normal process for deploying the team is that at the Assistant Secretary level, at a counterterrorism security group at the White House, those options are discussed. At that convening of that CSG, that decision is recommended or not recommended to the Deputies Committee. It is not solely a State Department function or authority to launch the Foreign Emergency Support Team, even though we are one part of it.
I thank the gentleman. We now go to the gentleman from Oklahoma, Mr. Lankford.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Hicks, when you arrived in July, did the facilities in Benghazi meet the minimum OSPB security standards set by the State Department?
According to the regional security officer at the time in Tripoli, John Martinek, they did not.
What about the facilities in Tripoli? The Benghazi facilities did not meet the minimum standards of the facilities in Tripoli?
Again, according to the regional security officer in Tripoli, John Martinek, they were very weak, yes. They did not meet.
They did not meet. Do you think they were close to meeting the standards?
No, sir.
Mr. Nordstrom, before you left as the RSO, did the facilities have the number of security personnel that you had requested?
No, they did not.
Mr. Nordstrom, there are a very, very small number of facilities worldwide that are considered by GAO critical or high threat level for personnel serving in our different embassies and consulates. Tripoli and Benghazi, were they listed as critical or high threat level?
They were. That was something that I had put in my written testimony as well.
Correct. By statute, Mr. Nordstrom, who has the authority to place personnel in a facility that does not meet the minimum OSPB standards?
As I had noted in there, the OSPB standards go in tandem with SECA, which is Secure Embassy Construction, both of which derived out of the East Africa bombings, or were strengthened after that. It's my understanding that since